The Big Day. This is the final track on the I Am Anonymous album. The Nord piano at the start, again, it's featured pretty heavily, actually, that Nord piano on this album. I just think it's the most realistic sounding piano around without having the luxury of miking up a nice Steinway grand piano in your front room. Now, I like the backing vocals as well at the start of this tune. There's some really nice kind of harmony parts that Pete and I did. We actually recorded them in Los Angeles in the London Hotel. We borrowed a really nice microphone off of Greg Price, who's Ozzy Osbourne's front of house engineer. I was out in Los Angeles with Ozzy, and Pete was out here with another band, One Eskimo, I think, who was on a tour. So we happened to cross paths, and it was the best opportunity we had to get together and record the backing vocal parts. And just goes to show, sometimes you don't need a $1,000 a day studio to record vocal parts, because we had a really, really nice microphone. We kind of made the room kind of so it wasn't quite so reflective, used the duvets and stuff, and kind of kitted it out so it was a bit more kind of dead for the vocals. And we had our headphones and stuff with us. Okay, everywhere with me, DT150s. Over two days we recorded all the backing vocals pretty much for the album in room 436 of the London Hotel, wherever it was, just off Sunset Strip. So it's really, that's kind of cool as well. You sort of remember different parts of the album when you hear things. It sort of triggers different points where you recorded them. And because this album was recorded in so many different places, it brings quite a lot of good memories. Now, at 1 minute in, there's this crazy Moog kind of sweep that goes on. It's actually recorded, it's all individual mono parts that sweep using the portamento between two different notes on as the chords change. So, for example, a C goes up to a two octave up A and then down to a two octaves below G. So each note in the chord is kind of picked out by this Moog sweep, and I think it's about 11 tracks of Moog that are happening. And that was inspired by an album my dad did called No Earthly Connection, which had I think the start of each side of the LP was this kind of this Moog noise, where it started as a high note and then it swept down to a low note. And I always loved it, especially because he told me how difficult that was to do back in 1977 or whenever it was he recorded it. And it was, you know, two 24 track tape machines full of Moog just at the start of the album. So that was kind of, that was really cool. I've always loved that album, my favorite of my dad's albums. And it just seemed to fit that kind of, that concept of the sort of sweeping Moogs, but I just took it to a slightly different direction and made it change with the chords in that sort of bridge section. So it kind of, you know, it sort of had movement, had crazy movement. If you listen to all the parts individually, it does sound pretty wacky. It sounds like somebody's just dropped 11 Moog synthesizers out of a window. But in the track, it sounds great. Now, 6 minutes 35 is the start of the outro of the whole album, really, and not just the outro of The Big Day. I really love this, the way the album came together and the way that kind of finished. And I remember when Pete and I were together working on it, it really felt that the album was rounded off when that piece was finished. And I thought I really wanted the choir back in on that. The choir sang on three tunes, Fall of America, In Hell's Name, and this track, The Big Day. And I wanted them to creep in and just help with the build without it getting to a big anthemic kind of chorus or anything at the end. It just kind of, you know, the pattern stays the same. The sopranos come in first, singing that kind of very simple, simplistic melody that just repeats and repeats. Then the altos come in, a harmony lower, and then the tenors, and then the basses. And it just kind of, it just builds without it getting overpowering. I really like that. There's a Rhodes part as well that just plays the same pattern throughout that entire section. It's very quiet. It's kind of quite a percussive sound. And again, using that kind of dissonant three notes together in a kind of pattern. and then that just repeats all the way through that end section. Another thing which some of you may have noticed is the beginning and end of the album start with the noise of a tank. Originally, when we were talking about the artwork, we were going to have a tank on the front cover, on one side of the front cover, and on the rear of the album was going to be the tank leaving the scene. You know, it was kind of this kind of apocalyptic scene. Now, what we had the tank at the beginning of the album comes on from one side. It comes on from right to left, I believe, and then at the end of the album it leaves on the opposite side. So the idea is, if you had the album on repeat, it would just cycle round. So the tank would leave and then it would come back in again on the other side. The idea is obviously the cycle of the themes of the album continue and will always continue, as with the CD, if you left it on repeat for the rest of your life. Thanks for hopefully buying the album and scanning the QR code. Alternatively, you may have just seen this on YouTube a few weeks later than the people lucky enough to scan the artwork in the booklet from the CD that they bought. Thanks for watching, and hopefully you like the album and you'll come and see us live. Cheers.
Right, The Big Day, which was definitely one of the final tracks. It had a working title for a while as Revelations, because it was always going to be that track that explained things a bit more clearly. But while we were writing it musically, it kind of had that title for a while. That wasn't a specific thing, but I remember being again up at Ad's place in Buckingham, and it was just one of those moments of kind of working on it. It was coming together musically with what we were doing, and I just had kind of that, ironically, revelation that the album, to have that kind of cyclical nature that he spoke about in one of his videos, of being able to listen to it from start to finish and then loop back to itself. And also the perspective change of how you kind of listen to the album. Initially, you might think of it from one point of view, and then by the end of it, you're actually seeing it or seeing it from almost, you know, the complete opposite or the complete polarized version of that. And I got quite excited about that. I remember phoning Damien up in Ad's kitchen and saying, kind of blurting out this stuff, and he was kind of like, okay, and then you know, started to kind of develop things lyrically as it was going along. And I think lyrically on this track for me is just awesome. I really, really think that, you know, Damien knocked it out of the park with this one, because it's the kind of killer twist at the end of the whole thing, and then I think that really creates a sense of both completion in the album and almost like completely raising, you know, debunking everything that you thought was happening in the album, kind of takes a shift, and then you're hearing it from a different perspective. So then when you listen again, it's kind of got a totally different perspective, which Damien did a great job with it. And it's one of those things that when I still listen to this one, I it really gives me a great sense of kind of completion. I'm really proud of it musically and what we accomplished with this track. The intro kind of unravels to slowly add parts. There's kind of crazy little loops and stuff which are sort of playing against the piano and guitar counterpoint, which is playing with the idea of where the downbeat is. We played around with different stuff with that, but it ended up there. And then when the drums sort of come in, it kind of spells out where one is, and big epic chords and big moogs going ballistic, which that was definitely an ad moment where he was talking kind of a reference to his dad and wanted to kind of do a modern day version of that, which he speaks about in his video, and it's really cool. And then, you know, for me, it was just kind of spelling out the chords underneath and the guitars are just really playing low notes, suggesting the chords that are underneath it. Again, complete contrast to the next part, which is the acoustic section. Again, this is one of those things where it just played itself, and it's that same Takamine guitar that Ad's pulled out of a bin And that same single SE mic that we used, single track guitar, and just came up with that. It's kind of got a little bit of unusual tuning. I think I tuned the high E string on the guitar up to F or something like that. I can't remember what it was, but it's just a really cool little thing, really nice acoustic thing. Damo's voice works really well with acoustic guitars, and he really, it's much more of one of those moments where that vocal kicks in that you want to listen to what he's saying more so than worry about all these instruments and stuff that are kicking off, and that's really important. So that one, sort of towards the end, it starts, the movement starts a bit more, where it kind of keeps playing kind of a vamp back and forth, and finishes on an unusual rhythm. The piano is playing in 7, and then the guitar is pretty much playing these accents of a riff, where the riff notes are the same, but then there's kind of gaps within it, which picks up on accents along with it, which is quite cool because it kind of keeps moving around. It's sort of, I guess, in a way, a little bit of King's X reference, with "We Were Born to Be Loved," but not really. But it used kind of a similar sort of element, and that's rips it a really cool thing. And 4:13, heaviness, really. That's just kind of like coming in. There's a kind of cool little slide solo that kind of moves, built into the chugging, and I like that sort of, there's nice kind of chiming happening, but then a big dirty guitar, and there's the filter that's kind of sweeping up around it, which are those things that adds kind of played that filter in, which was really cool. It's got really peaks up to it and kind of comes back down, and then at the end of it, it's got that classic kind of half time kind of drop down heavy section, which is always nice, and then add a little bit of space before the Hammond solo kind of fires in, where the riff behind is kind of like a reduction. It kind of adds notes each time, and then it takes them away, so it's kind of the signatures are moving against it, again, which just creates a little bit of jerkiness rhythmically through it. 6:12, there's a bluesy kind of guitar solo, some of the vibrato and stuff in there was very kind of much Steve Morse sort of inspired sort of thing. That thing, it's quite hard to play like that on an 8-string guitar in a lower register, because on a longer scale one, like what I use with a 30-inch scale, I use 10s on it for the normal guitar, and then the tension is a lot higher than a regular guitar, so to bend up even a tone, bend on a guitar down sort of, yeah, you know, around the fifth fret on the G string, or you know, bending up from the C, or from the B flat, it's really hard physically. It took a while to kind of, once I build those guitars, to develop the strength to be able to do that kind of stuff. So that's quite cool. And then at the end of it, it finishes with a big kind of alternate picked chromatic line into the final payoff section. It's just kind of like, again, toys out of pram, loads of notes kind of running down, but it's the idea of kind of craziness, which at the end of that solo then just kind of hits you into the final section, which is the 6:35 kind of big outro choruses. And I really love this. It's kind of, you know, rhythmically quite simple, but just keeps kind of chugging away. I really like this section. This one, I always get goosebumps when I hear this end bit. But it's kind of, I'm really proud of it, just with the way everything kind of came together. Lyrically, it's just killer, and it's something that was really inspired that Demi came up with. And then the chugs underneath it, just really simple stuff. And there's that kind of slide counter melody running over the top of it, which I like that kind of thing. You know, there's a really staccato chugging going on, and then something soaring over the top of it in a higher register, you know, so it gives some cool contrast. There's acoustic guitar strumming away, there's that really nice little Rhodes piano bit that's kind of just a little motive that keeps moving away, pointing it. And all the things, all the elements really add together. I think that's kind of true of the band, really, you know, in the creation of this album, where all those little bits, it's the sum of its parts, you know, so all together it really adds into a great track. And then by the end, once the, you know, there's the choir in there again at the very end, really lifting it. We just did a great job, and then shrinks right back down to just that strumming guitar. I used a demo one again. I think I did. Just that Takamina again. And vocal, and then that little slide part on it, which really open and cool. And just, again, just lets the final lyric, you know, no one's here, no one's there. Just really hit home, you know, you listen to that and it's kind of like you've been really taken on a journey. And the very end, the tank kind of rolling out, brings you full circle to the start of the album again as it rolls in, or the other way around, depending on how you depending on how you look at it. But that's kind of all part of the fun. So yeah, thanks very much for checking out the album and watching these little clips with me and ads, and hope to see you on the road soon playing this stuff, and yeah, thank you very much.